Colossians 1 Part 4. And although you were previously alienated and hostile in attitude, engaged in evil deeds. As children of Adam, we were alienated from God and maintained a hostile attitude toward Him. This is the condition of the natural heart. Sin alienated us from our Creator, and pride would blame God for that alienation. The only thing the flesh knows how to do is sin, and we were fully engaged in evil deeds. You might think this is an exaggeration, that some things men do are good or at least harmless. Think again. In Proverbs, God takes three things that seem upright, or at least harmless, and calls them an abomination. Scripture tells us the plowing of the wicked is an abomination to the Lord, the sacrifice of the wicked is an abomination to the Lord, and that the prayer of the wicked is also an abomination to the Lord. The reason is that man has left God out of his thoughts, and everything he does has himself as the object. Yet he has now reconciled you in his body of flesh through death, in order to present you before him holy and blameless and beyond reproach, if indeed you continue in the faith firmly established and steadfast, and not shifting from the hope of the gospel that you have heard, which was proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and of which I, Paul, was made a minister. Now God has intervened in the person of his own dear Son. Jesus took our sins on his own body while on the cross. He was made sin, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God. During his second 3 hours on the cross, while darkness covered the whole earth, our guilt was laid upon him. He was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we have been healed. To reconcile means to completely clear the books. All is settled. The Old Testament words were "the soul that sins, it shall die." In dying for our sins, the debt was cleared. Jesus paid it all. It is not just the removal of sins past, but a whole new standing as holy, blameless, and beyond reproach. Paul cautions them against departing and shifting away from this wonderful gospel. Paul is not teaching that we lose our salvation but showing the end of rejecting the gospel or exchanging it for the Gnostic message. Although he was not the one to originally preach the gospel to the Colossians, the apostle takes responsibility for it. It was he who was chosen by God to reveal the mysteries of the gospel that had been hidden in the Old Testament. Let's take a moment and break that down a bit. From the fall, the gospel of a coming Messiah had been given to mankind. There was the promise that the seed of the woman would crush the serpent's head, while having his own heel bruised. All through the many long years from the fall to the cross, God, through the prophets and the law, filled in the blanks and painted an ever clearer picture of the suffering Messiah. Through Enoch, the seventh generation down from Adam, came the revelation that the Lord would come in judgment with his holy myriads. Through the story of Noah we learn of deliverance from judgment. God promised Abraham that in his seed, Christ, all the nations of the earth would be blessed and that he would provide for himself a lamb. The law, given to Moses, unfolded the many aspects of God's holy requirements and his means of covering sin until it could be reconciled in the death of the Lamb of God. Psalm 22 portrays the crucifixion of Christ before the Romans even invented this gruesome means of death. Isaiah and the other prophets spoke of coming salvation and worldwide blessing. Daniel 4 told a Messiah being cut off and having nothing, and then a coming kingdom when the Lord will have dominion over the whole earth. The wonderful things of Christ and the church were hidden in God until Christ rose from the dead and ascended to the Father's right hand. Once the Lord Jesus was glorified, he sent the Holy Spirit and the fullness of the mysteries were revealed. Now I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I am supplementing what is lacking in Christ's afflictions in behalf of his body, which is the church. Paul is not speaking here of the atoning sufferings of the Lord on the cross. It would have been blasphemy to suggest that he in any way supplemented those sufferings. The Lord's first words to Paul, "Then Saul were Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" He learned that Christ and the church are one body. He was transformed from an inflictor of sufferings to a willing participant of those sufferings. He would endure all things for the sake of the church that he once persecuted. Note again how Scripture equates the church or assembly with the whole body of Christ. This is one of the most repeated doctrinal statements in the New Testament, because it is a foundational truth. Those who diminish the church or assembly to something smaller, some sect or remnant testimony, show their neglect for the mind and heart of God. Of course, some do this in ignorance, simply parroting what they have been taught by others who should have known better. I was made a minister of this church according to the commission from God granted to me for your benefit, so that I might fully carry out the preaching of the Word of God, that is, the mystery which had been hidden from the past ages and generations, but now has been revealed to His saints, to whom God willed to make known what the wealth of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles is, the mystery that is Christ in you, the hope of glory. This is quite a mouthful here. As a servant of not only God, but of His church, Paul carried out the preaching of the Word of God. It is significant that the Holy Spirit uses the words "this church" here. It marks it as a distinct thing. Which church is it? What called out assembly is referred to? The one that is the body of Christ, as Paul just mentioned. This distinction answers those who would teach that the church is somehow the continuation of assembly of Israel. Paul explains that the mystery referred to here is Christ in you, the hope of glory. He makes it very clear that this mystery was hidden in past ages and generations. We will not find it, except in types, in the Old Testament. It is, for want of a better word, a new administration or dispensation. Christ in the believer, individually and collectively in the church, is not something taught in the Old Testament. And particularly in Gentile believers. The church united with Christ in the most intimate way extend the hope, a differed certainty in Scripture, of glory with Christ. The words do not fit conveniently in our thoughts, so we do best to letter the words of Scripture form our thoughts. We proclaim Him, admonishing every person and teaching every person with all wisdom, so that we may present every person complete in Christ. This is serious, purposeful discipleship. Christ is set before the soul as the supreme object of our faith. Everything is tied up in Him, and we are complete in Him. I understand complete here to mean lacking nothing. He is the answer to all our needs, and the focus of all our hopes. As we disciple young converts, we must not present Christ as the means to some end, but as the end itself. That is what the Gospel teaches us. For this purpose I also labor, striving according to His power which works mightily within me. The aged apostle continued, though in bonds, to labor with all intensity to this end, knowing that it was God's mighty power at work in him, though he was restricted and weak. Paul's doctrine continues to teach us these many years later, with the same mighty power.